So I want to tell you about Poncelet's porism, which is a theorem which blew the minds of 19th century mathematicians. It was a really exciting moment. A lot of people tried to come up with their own proofs. I'm not going to explain the proof. I just want to tell you what it's about and maybe a little bit about why it's so cool and surprising. And I have to admit, I don't know what a porism is. Some people call it Poncelet's closure theorem, but porism is so cool that that's what we're going to use today.
You don't know what a porism is?
I don't know what a porism is.
We'll Google that. But it means like a theorem or a...
Probably. I don't even want to venture a guess. It could mean anything. So you start with two conics. So like two ellipses. Let's say one is inside the other. And what do? You start with a point on one, and you draw the tangent line to the other one through that point, or one of the tangent lines. And it intersects the other conic at some point. And now you can take this point and draw... Well, we already have one tangent line through this point and the second conic, but you draw the other one. Now you get a third point, and you keep going. You draw the tangent line, and you keep bouncing around. Eventually, maybe you close up.
Oh. All right.
So suppose you close up.
So you might get back to where you started.
Yeah, so you might get back to where you started. After some number of times bouncing around this picture. You might not. But here's the theorem. So suppose you eventually get back to where you started. So you started at this point, you bounce around a lot, and eventually you come back. Then the same thing happens if you start at any point. So all you have to know is that if you start here, you bounce around, you come back. Well, what happens if you started here? The same thing would be true. You'd bounce around a bunch of times, and eventually you'd come back to where you started. So that's Poncelet's theorem.
And I guess by extension, if you don't come back to where you started, that's also true for any point.
That's right. Because if it was true for some other point, then, well, you would know there's some point where you start and bounce around, so for your original point, you'd also, by the same theorem, have to bounce around and come back to where you started.
Okay.
So that's the result. So why was this so exciting? I'm not going to say much about the proof, but the reason why is that the proof used some objects called elliptic curves or elliptic functions, which were really exciting at the time. And everyone had to come up with their own proof of this using elliptic functions or elliptic curves. And people were still doing that as late as like the 1960s or 1970s, including some of the, you know, giants of algebraic geometry.
So that was the shiny new toy of mathematics at the time.
Yeah, and I think it was just really exciting that there's some, you know, fairly elementary statement you could make that you could apply these really fancy new tools, these really exciting and, you know, beautiful objects to study and prove.
Was the first proof using that, or was it already proven and then people came along and said, I bet we could do that with elliptic curves?
Yeah, so I think what happened was Poncelet's proof didn't intrinsically use these ideas, or he didn't know maybe he was using these ideas, and then a little bit later, Jacobi came along, and he was like, oh, I know how to prove this using elliptic integrals. But this was right at the beginning of the time people were starting to understand elliptic curves, which actually came from some interesting calculus problems called elliptic integrals. And so I think the excitement came from, you know, people looking at Poncelet's proof and realizing, oh, there's something really beautiful happening here.
Do we know what properties of the ellipses make a joining star and what ones make them not join, or is it just a random thing?
Yeah, so in fact there's some really beautiful geometry hidden here. Associated to these two conics, there's a sort of diagram like this. So it's some kind of parallelogram, where you think of these sides as the same and these sides as the same. So actually, this is one way of thinking about an elliptic curve. There's a picture like this, and also is associated to it a little arrow, so a vector. And here's another thing you can do, just like this, another kind of operation you can perform on a picture like this. You can add the vector to itself. So you can do this, and then do this. And well, maybe you get here, but that's the same as this point, because we said these two sides were the same. Go do this, and do this, and do this. And that's the same as this point, which is the same as this point. And the way we can tell if you wrap around and get to where you get is exactly this, if the same thing is true on this picture. If once you add this vector to itself enough times, you get back to where you started. So this is the associated elliptic curve.
I don't see the link between the parallelogram and the...
Yeah, I haven't told it to you.
Okay.
Yeah, so in fact, I can say a little bit about it. So what you do is you identify this with the... Let me give the conics names. So this inner one is C and this one is D. So you identify this with the set of points C and D, where C is a point of C and D is a point of D, and the line through C and D is tangent to C at point C. And it turns out there's a natural way to go from this set to this parallelogram. In particular, it has this kind of addition law on it.
So if I said to you, Daniel, I want you to draw two ellipses that will work, that will create this cool property, you would use that?
I would try to reverse engineer it, that's right.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah.
It's funny, when you started talking about elliptic curves, you didn't draw a single curved line.
That's right, yeah. So an elliptic curve people often draw is looking at like something like this. So that's the real solutions to an equation that looks like this.
Hmm.
But if you instead you look at the complex solutions, you get a picture like this. So in fact, this is, if you think about gluing this side to this side and this side to this side, you get a donut. And what's this picture? It's, well, this loop goes over here, and this one is kind of some shadow of a loop over here.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Our thanks to Brilliant for supporting today's episode. Brilliant is an amazing collection of quizzes and courses and daily challenges, all sorts of things you can do to really sharpen your brain. It's great for just some fun passing the time or really going deep into subjects that maybe you feel like you're not across, like number theory or calculus or probability. I've been lucky enough to meet some of the people at Brilliant. I've even been to their offices. They're so passionate about making people smarter, about educating the world. They hope you not only go and use Brilliant, but they're also supporting all sorts of science and mathematics outreach, like Numberphile. If you want to go check out what they're doing, go to brilliant.org/numberphile. The /numberphile lets them know you came from here, but it also gets you 20% off their premium subscription if you decide to sign up for that. The premium subscription gets you all the good stuff. brilliant.org/numberphile. Our thanks to them, as always, for supporting our videos.